only a bunch of Christians would stand outside in the snowstorm at a funeral singing, "It is well with my soul." We're not going to sing that this morning, but it was just, it's true. And because of what we celebrated yesterday, we can all sing it as well. But instead of that, we're going to stand, grab a hymnal, and we're going to sing Hark the Herald Angels Sing, which is 192. And I will do my best to try to remember to announce the numbers. The next one will be 201. You may not be familiar with that one. The others, I'm sure you know, but as I said, I'll try to remember to announce the numbers.
Thank you. matter of our presence is bringing an offering of our time. Our expectations are high, so we expect God to say something today. I apologize a little bit for the lower octave of my voice. I tried to set a record for coughing yesterday, and I think I won, but there was no database to find out for sure. But isn't this the greatest time of the year? Kids might say, well, no, it's the day school's out for the summer, but you just can't beat Christmas. Family, friends. And some are here. But the memories are good. Don't know that I do this right. It's just part of being mom. My dad was the same way. I rarely find sermon material on Facebook. There's a lot of junk, and I'm not a big fan. I love Facebook for one reason, that it does get the gospel out. It does let us continue to preach and sing the gospel when they put it online. And I love that part. Never been a big Facebooker. But I was scanning some this year. Betty, a couple of days ago, Betty had posted this, and I think she showed it to me. And then she reposted it, and you may have seen it. But I thought it was classic because it was Christmas. Santa is sitting at his desk, and he's got pen in hand. And the caption says, "Dear Mr. and Mrs. Smith, I just received Kevin's letter. If you will leave $100 under the cookie plate, I will not deliver the drum set." We often think of Christmas as stuff and things. Stuff is okay. I love the decorations downtown. Oh, it's so beautiful. And I think it's great that we celebrate the birth of Jesus Christ that way. However, Jesus' birth was kind of in the middle of God's plan. Well, maybe toward the end a little bit. But God's always had a plan. Read Genesis. In the beginning, who? God created heavens and the earth. And it goes about him fulfilling his plan for 7 days and creating and separating and adding the animals and us. That's when he first started to show that he had a plan. And then when he created Adam and Eve, showed them that his plan involved them. And not just that they would be a creature on the earth that he created, but that they would be a friend to him. That they would be a relationship. They would represent God having a relationship with mankind, and he's still about that today. I mentioned a moment ago, Christmas is about family. Think about it for a second. You may not have thought of it this way, but it came to me this week that I was looking at this and I thought, Mary and Joseph are starting their family. And that is not a coincidence. God's always been about people. He's always been about family. And he brought Jesus to earth as a part of the family. Isaiah 7:14 says, "And a virgin shall bring forth her firstborn, and his name will be called Emmanuel." And in Isaiah 9:6, we have a passage that we don't quote as often as we should, but we hear it a lot at Christmas time. "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulders, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. In the Garden of Eden with Adam and Eve, he did show, though, that his plan had some limitations. While it included them, and he loved them, they were not allowed to do whatever they wanted. They had free reign in the garden. They could eat anything but one tree. And that's when we find out that Satan also had a plan. But Satan's plan, while it is still ongoing, is not what we want to concentrate on today. Christmas is joyful, but it's about the love of God who sent his only Son. At the birth of Jesus, we call it, I'm not sure who "we" is. I think it must be just mostly theologians because you don't hear it a lot. But it's the incarnation, the beginning. We call Jesus' birth the incarnation. The incarnation is God beginning to reveal to mankind his plan for them. He's been trying to tell them for centuries. He showed that he was worthy of their trust with Abraham, with all the children of Israel, and then when he actually saved the nation of Israel by sending them to Egypt, which didn't end well, but he got them out after the slavery started and another king had come into place. God took care of them. He sent them across the Red Sea. They didn't get it. Often, again and again and again, he saved them from the maladies of life. He saved them from other nations. Because he had a plan and he wasn't going to let go of his plan. He implemented that plan. And so, the birth we celebrate is because Jesus was keeping a promise that he had made. And Isaiah told us what his name would be. He told us a lot of things through all the prophets. He kept on and on and on trying to get them to understand how much he loved them and how much he cared for them and that he could be trusted. But still, even after Jesus was born, they just tried to find reasons to kill him. So there was the incarnation, the birth. I'm going to pause for a second. It's really interesting. This little bit of alliteration that I'm going to go through in the next few minutes. When Matt called me, I said, I'll have to check with my folks and see what they want to do. But before I had it, was that on Saturday or Friday? I don't remember. And I said, well, I'll check with my people and we'll see what they want to do. And so I again to get this alliterated concept that I'm giving you today. And I've got 2 half pages of notes. That's based on 6 that I had when I started typing. It's like God never stopped throwing stuff at me all week long. I had more fun, and then every time I'd hear something, I'd write it down. But fortunately, God showed me what to take out. But you remember the triumphal entry? When Jesus enters into Jerusalem for the very last time. What an incredible time. All of the accolades that they were giving him, they were rejoicing and praising God. They were giving Jesus the coronation of, like a king would get. And I thought, how incredibly valuable that is for us to realize that even the people at the time that were following Jesus realized that he was a kingly man. That he was the King of Kings. He was the Lord of Lords. God had been trying to tell him that he was coming and that he would be. The government shall be upon his shoulders. He will be mighty God. He is mighty God. And then, you know, God's plan was always about Jesus. Jesus was always the plan from creation. God knew that we couldn't cut it, and that we wouldn't cut it, and that we wouldn't be obedient, and that we would have to admit to ourselves that we are sinful creatures. That's why Jesus has always, always, always been God's plan. So Jesus comes. He is born. At the triumphal entry, we call it the coronation. But you know, that was just the beginning and the end, because within just a few days, Jesus was on the cross, bleeding and suffering, and crying out, my God, why have you forsaken me? All necessary. All necessary. The shedding of blood. We remember the time that he shared with the disciples in what we now call and celebrate the Lord's Supper. That was the culmination of God's plan. Jesus dying on the cross to save all mankind. But it seems that we still don't care. But you know, we've talked about the incarnation. We've talked about the coronation. We've talked about the culmination on the cross, where God brings the sacrifice. Jesus was the only person that could legally be crowned king because he was the son of David. But in that moment, and being crucified, he said, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. They don't realize how big a part they're playing in your plan. But there's something missing. And that's the consummation. God's done all the work. He created the world. He created mankind. All through the history of mankind, God showed himself and revealed himself to be worthy of trust. And ultimately, he sent Jesus Christ as the crowning moment of showing how much he could be trusted, because he kept the promise he had been telling the children of Israel for eons. He kept the promise because he could be trusted. But how do we get to the consummation? Consummation, the word consummation always implies at least two coming together to agree upon something. Consummation's up to you. God did the work. He provided Jesus. Jesus did his part. He gave his life on the cross. One of my favorite passages and statements about Jesus is, he says, and this is my version, make no mistake about it, nobody gets my life, but I willingly give it. But the consummation, how does it happen? John 3:16. Probably the most quoted verse in the world by Christians and non-Christians alike. For God so loved the world, he's been showing it for centuries, that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever, that's everybody that ever existed and will exist, believeth in him. Whosoever believeth or believes in him will not die, but have eternal, everlasting life. All spiritual terminology there, because we know that as sure as we are alive, we will pass from this life. Bible tells us that it's appointed for man once to die, but after that there's a judgment. How do you avoid being judged for your sin? You believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, to quote another scripture, and you shall be saved. Funny word, believe. But it seems to always come up. I've recently had a resurgence of energy regarding getting myself requalified as a private pilot. I mean, I have my license. They can't take that away. Well, they could if I did something really stupid, which I've done a few things stupid as a pilot, but nothing catastrophic. It's okay to laugh. My brother taught me how to fly in the 70s. We were flying from Wings for Christ in Texas. It was a fun time. Then there was, you know, when you first start taking flying lessons, the thing you want to do the most is your first solo, where you by yourself are in the plane and you get to fly it and you're the only one in jeopardy. Well, we were flying around the pattern, and I did some touch and goes and did some maneuvers, and then he said, this time I want you to do a full stop landing, but land real short. We had a 10,000 foot runway. I was flying a Cessna Skyhawk, which only needs about 1,500 feet to get off the ground. So I stopped, and he said, pull over to the edge. You know what he did? He got out. I was terrified. The moment I've been waiting for to show my stuff that I could do it. And he said, Just do what I taught you to do, the way I taught you to do it, and you're going to be fine. Besides that, if I let anything happen to you, Mother would kill me. Taxied out to the center line, pushed the throttle to the firewall, tightened it in place, waited for that airspeed indicator to get up to about 60 miles per hour, and eased back on the yoke just a little bit. That plane just flies itself off the ground. But something incredible happened when those main wheels lifted off the ground. I said out loud to myself, "You've done it now." You see, takeoffs are optional, but landings are mandatory. So, in that moment, there was no doubt in my mind that I had made a commitment in my life. That is what Jesus meant when he said, "Believe." It's a commitment of life. It's not just words, though the words are there and they're important. It's always been a matter of the heart. Remember what Pilate said? "What do you want me to do with Jesus?" If you want to help God, and this is really true, consummate his plan so it helps you too, then the first thing you need to do is trust Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. And the commitment is not just a momentary thing, but a commitment to live a life for him. Every moment you're alive. So today, if you haven't taken that step and stepped into the kingdom of God by trusting your life, your well-being, everything you think you are and might possibly become, today's a banner day for you, because you can consummate God's plan for you today. We're going to have an invitation. Normal thing in the Baptist church. And the invitation is for you to step out into the aisle. I'll be standing here to pray with you, so that you can ask Jesus. Yeah, you can ask him in your seat, but he said if you don't show people, if you don't tell somebody, then that's when the trust really consummates. You must. We say do it publicly, because it's not to be kept a secret. So, Penny's going to sing a song, if you'll stand with me. Listen to the song, and we'll have a closing prayer in a few minutes, but this is your opportunity. Maybe for you, you need to have a time of renewal of your commitment. You just listen to the voice of God, and you do what God is nudging you to do.
Come on, just as you are. Thank you.
was thinking when I was sitting in the pew, before I came up here. I don't know if you think about it this way, but this church is an icon. It's a lighthouse that has been responsible for bringing thousands of people to Jesus. That's what Jesus told us that we were here for. He said, go. Tell. We sang it a moment ago. Go tell it in the mountain. Maybe here we'd say, go tell it in the pasture. Cows don't necessarily need to be saved, but it might make some good practice. So as we begin to close, I'm going to take a privilege here, and I'm going to ask our deacon Rogers to lead us in our closing prayer. Is there anything else we need to be aware of, be done? I would ask you, somebody did ask me about Casey, if he was going to be here to lead music today. Casey is down with something, the crud or whatever it is, it has been for several days. And remember Deb Vandegrift and that family, she lost her mom this week. And and any others you can think of. So Garland, would you lead us to the throne of God as we dismiss, please?
Our most gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we just want to give you thanks for this day. We want to thank you, Father, for this church, for Locust Grove, and each one of the representative churches, and especially the leaders of these churches. We just ask, Father, that as we go into this new season, we just ask to be with each one of us, prepare us for a new year. We want to ask all these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen. God bless you.
Thank you. should turn it off to record.
Yes.